Good morning to all of you. So today I'm going to talk on EA and CA mass spectrometry, and I will try to cover the interpretation of mass spectra. So before I go about talking on mass spectrometry and interpretation aspects, I would like to give a brief introduction to historical developments in mass spectrometry to remember the great scientists who contributed immensely to the field of mass spectrometry. As all of you are aware, mass spectrometry is a powerful analytical technique for determination of molecular weight of small to large molecules and also structural sedation. And the technique of mass spectrometry originated from J.J. Thomson's vacuum discharge tube, which demonstrated the existence of electrons and positive rays. And based on the principle that charged particles can be deflected using electric and magnetic fields, J.J. Thomson built first mass spectrometer. He is called father of mass spectrometry. He received Nobel Prize. And then Dempster built commercial mass spectrometer using electron ionization and magnetic focusing as analyzer. The early applications of mass spectrometry remained in the realms of physics, particularly for the discovery of isotopes of various elements. Aston did a lot of work, and he also received Nobel Prize for his contributions to the discovery of isotopes of various elements. Then I think the classical example is the neon 20 and 22. And because of the limitation of the single focusing mass spectrometers, then scientists started looking for double focusing mass spectrometers, particularly limitation with respect to resolution. Okay, and then Mettak-Herzog and Neil Johnson, these two pair of scientists, you know, they developed double focusing mass spectrometers. This has paved the way for high resolution mass spectrometry. And I'm sure, I think all of you are aware the benefits and the advantages of high resolution mass spectrometry, wherein, you know, you get elemental compositions of molecular ion as well as fragment ions. And the concept of time of flight mass analysis was demonstrated by Stephens in 1946, and concept of using quadrupole analyzers as mass analyzers was demonstrated by Wolfgang Pohl from Germany. He also received a Nobel Prize in 89. Yeah. Then full-fledged high-resolution mass spectrometry was developed by Professor Bainin, and GCMS, it's a high-penetrated technique that was introduced by McLafferty and co-workers, and this has paved the way for the analysis of complicated mixers using mass spectrometry. Then Professor Munsen and Field, they developed a softer ionization technique called chemical ionization. Compounds which are not amenable to electron ionization can be analyzed using chemical ionization. I'll be talking about chemical ionization later. And then Marshall and co-workers developed FTICRMS, that is Fourier Transform Ion Cyclotron Resonance Mass Spectrometer. Briefly, you know, like in contrast to conventional mass spectrometry, in FTICRMS, everything takes place, you know, like source ion, ion generation, analysis, and detection. Everything takes place in a small cubic cell placed in very high magnetic field of the order of, you know, like more than 5 Tesla. And the image currents are produced, and from there, you know, like you get the mass spectra. This is a very complicated mass spectrometer, and because of that, you know, like it got confined to only research laboratories. But it's a very high resolution mass spectrometer. You get millions of resolution. So then Professor Mickey Barber at UMIST, that is University of Manchester Institute of Technology, developed fast atom bombardment mass spectrometry. In fast atom bombardment mass spectrometry, samples are mixed with a matrix substance like glycerol or metanitrobenzyl alcohol, and then bombarded with fast-moving atoms of xenon or argon. Then you get ions which on desorption. And this has, you know, like paved the way for the analysis of molecules of biological interest. Until then, you know, like even simple molecules like sugars, amino acids could not be analyzed using electron ionization and chemical ionization. Then, you know, like its later version was LSI, that is liquid secondary ion. Fast atom bombardment has the limitation with respect to the molecular weight hardly, you know, you can go up to 3,000 to 4,000. Then came, you know, like these techniques, electrospray ionization and matrix assisted laser desorption ionization. Electrospray ionization was developed by Professor Fenn and MALDI by Professor Koichi Tanaka. And the development of these two techniques have really revolutionized the field of mass spectrometry. Because, you know, like any type of sample can be analyzed, both, you know, like a small, large, even like polymers, both synthetic polymers as well as biopolymers can be analyzed using these two techniques. And then there were other developments, but another latest development is Orbitrap mass spectrometer, which was introduced by Thermo in 2005. It was developed by Makarov. And before that, a lot of history is there for the development of that, you know, like Kingdon developed that spindle electrode and, you know, but I will not go into the details. And in fact, intact viral analysis was also demonstrated. And other important developments in the field of mass spectrometry is hyphenation of HPLC with API-MS, okay? Although the hyphenation of HPLC with mass spectrometers took place in the 70s, but only after the advent of electrospray ionization, this HPLC, ESI-MS or LC-MS has become very, very popular, not only in the hands of chemists, also biochemists and biologists. And it's already, you know, like mass spectrometry has already found a niche in proteomics and metabolomics. And, you know, it's in the forefront, in fact, in the forefront of proteomics and metabolomics. I'm sure I think all of you are aware about metabolomics. It's a very, what do you call it? It's a very interesting and, you know, like a challenging field. It's concerned with the development of biomarkers for various diseases. Okay. So I'll just give one example in, you know, like biomarker research. There are lots of other developments. The scientists at Austin University developed a mass spec pen, which can identify cancer in 10 seconds. Okay, very briefly, you see, like the pen is touched onto suspected cancer portion, which releases a tiny droplets, and chemicals inside the living cells move into the droplet, which is then sucked back into the pen for analysis. The pen is plugged into a mass spectrometer, which produces a chemical fingerprint that tells doctors whether they are looking at a tissue which is, you know, like normal or cancer. So that is, these are the kind of developments that are taking place in the field of mass spectrometry. This is, you know, Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2002. Professor Fenn and Koichi Tanaka received Nobel Prize for their contributions to ESI and MALDI respectively. And Uthrich also shared the Nobel Prize for his contributions to NMR. Okay, let us see what is mass spectrometry. So, mass spectrometry is a powerful analytical technique for molecular weight determination and also structural sedation of small to large molecules. As I said, I think all even synthetic polymers as well as biopolymers such as peptides, proteins, and nucleotides can be analyzed using mass spectrometry. And one can identify unknown compounds and quantify known chemicals. That is both qualitative analysis as well as quantitative analysis. And as all of you are aware, the beauty of this technique is it requires minute quantities of the analyte, like less than picogram, 10 to the power of minus 12 gram is sufficient for the analysis. And you can identify analyte molecules at very low concentrations in complex matrices like biological fluids, like urine sample, viscera samples, etc. And because of its high sensitivity, selectivity, and speed, mass spectrometry finds applications in wide variety of research and development areas. In fact, there is no field where mass spectrometry is not used, like chemistry, physics, biology, forensic science, nuclear chemistry, interstellar chemistry, drug discovery and development, etc. So as far as the drug discovery and development is concerned, mass spectrometry is used at each and every field, right from target identification to impurity profiling. LC-MS plays a pivotal role. So let us see what is a mass spectrometer. So mass spectrometer, as all of you are aware, it's an instrument which produces a beam of ions, separates them according to mass to charge ratios, and registers their masses and intensities. So basically three processes takes place in a mass spectrometer. First one is ionization, that neutral molecules are converted to ions, because mass spectrometers can detect only ions. And these ions are separated by an analyzer, and they are detected using a detector. We'll go into the details. So these are the components of a mass spectrometer. The first one is inlet, okay? Inlet means how you introduce the samples into the source of the mass spectrometer. Generally, solid samples are introduced using a solid probe. On the top of it, a crucible, so a quartz crucible is placed into that small amount of sample is introduced. And solid probe is introduced into the source of the mass spectrometer using a vacuum interlock, because mass spectrometers are maintained at very high vacuum. So a vacuum interlock is used to introduce the solid probe into the source of the mass spectrometer. And the liquid samples are injected using a liquid inlet system using a syringe. And GCMS and LCMS are used for these hyphenated techniques are used for introducing mixers into the source of the mass spectrometer. So GCMS is used for volatile and stable samples, whereas LCMS is capable of analyzing even non-volatile and thermally labile samples or mixers, okay? And ion source is the place where the ions are generated, and then they are mass, they are subjected to mass analysis using a mass analyzer, and they are detected. And all these components are maintained at very high vacuum of the order of 10 to the power of minus 6 to minus 8, depending on the type of the mass spectrometer. And this vacuum, is generally produced by rotary pumps in combination with thermomolecular pumps. So rotary pump gives a vacuum of 10 to the power of minus 3, which is 4 vacuum, is a must necessary to start the high vacuum. Okay, that's a thermomolecular pumps. And then you have the data system, which is, which acquires the data, processes the data, controls the mass spectrometer, and stores the data. Of course, many other things are done using data system. So all are controlled by electronics, okay? And then you have the output, the mass spectrum, which is given by the data system. I'm just showing a small, simple mass spectrum of a very simple molecule like carbon dioxide. Just to impress upon you that, what type of information. It is for the benefit of youngsters, the beginners. See, you get the molecular ion at MBZ 44, and also fragment ions at 28, 16, 12, corresponding to, C plus dot, O plus dot, and CO, etc. So you get molecular weight information as structural information from a mass spectrum in principle. So it is something like taking a jar, breaking it into pieces, and putting all the pieces together to get back the structure of the jar or the jar itself. Okay, so that is how sample molecules are subjected to fragmentation in the mass spectrometer, and then you get molecular weight information and the fragment ions, which are characteristic of the structure of the sample, and putting all this information together. In principle, it is possible to arrive at the structure. So I'm just giving various ionization techniques. From a mass spectrometrist point of view, all the analytes can be categorized into volatile and non-volatile compounds. Volatile compounds can be analyzed using electron impact or electron ionization mass spectrometry and chemical ionization mass spectrometry. And non-volatile and thermally labile samples can be analyzed using desorption ionization techniques. So I will not go into the details of field desorption, fast atom bombardment, secondary ion mass spectrometry, and plasma desorption, because they have become obsolete. Obsolete in the sense, still some scientists are using in their laboratories, but these two techniques, MALDI, that is matrix assisted laser desorption ionization technique, and electrospray ionization technique. So these two techniques are sufficient, or in the sense, they can cover all the types of samples, whether they are volatile or non-volatile, thermally labile, etc., and very high molecular weight samples, as I told before. So now I will briefly discuss about the electron ionization mass spectrometry, which is one of the oldest technique, but still it is a very popular technique because 60 to 70% of volatile samples can be analyzed using electron impact ionization mass spectrometry. In electron impact ionization mass spectrometry, the sample molecules or analyte molecules are bombarded or in subjected to bombardment by 70 electron volts. Okay, it takes place in a small cubic chamber, steel cubic chamber, which is of 1 centimeter cube dimension. And the important components in this source chamber are a filament, which is made up of rhenium or tungsten. And opposite to that, you have a ion trap, okay, which acts like a anode. When the filament is cathode, it likes a anode. And in the bottom, you have the repeller. And when the filament is switched on, the electrons are ejected from the filament and they travel towards the anode in circular paths, so that the probability of interaction between the electrons and the sample molecules gets increased. Okay, and ionization takes place by removal of one electron from the outermost orbital to form M plus dot. It is cation radical. Okay, this M plus dot, which represents the molecular ion, undergoes fragmentation to give fragment ions and neutrals or radicals. Neutrals and radicals are not detected, whereas fragment ions are detected. Why the fragmentation takes place? Because of the excess energy. For example, an excess energy of 30 electron volts is equal to 3000 kilojoules per mole. And as all of you are aware, the bond energies of most of the chemical bonds, whether it is CH or CX or CO, CH, it lies in 300 to 600 kilojoules per mole. Okay, so because of the excess energy, the fragmentation takes place. Fortunately for us, you know, like you get a lot of fragment ions, so which helps in structural oxidation. So now the ions which are generated, which are formed in the source, they are repelled by the repeller into the analyzer. And they're also given acceleration voltage. Now the ion beam is focused into the analyzer by means of ion optical lenses. Okay, I will not go into the details. So let us see what happens in the analyzer. So there are different types of mass analyzers depending on the type of instrument. In sector mass spectrometers, the magnetic sector analyzer and electrostatic analyzers are used. In quadrupole mass spectrometers, it's a quadrupole analyzer. In time of flight mass spectrometer, it is a time of flight analyzer. It's a tube. And then ion trap mass analyzer, it's an ion trap. Ions are trapped. In orbit trap analyzer, okay, like ions are also trapped by means of, you know, like outer barrel electrode and a spindle electrode, which, when the ions move in orbital motion around the spindle and they produce image currents. I think you already heard this talk. And then you have ion cyclotron resonance mass spectrometer. Okay, basically these are the type of mass spectrometers. And common to all these analyzers is the separation of particles on the basis of M by Z ratio. So now I'm just going to briefly explain the basic mass spectrometry equation which governs the separation of ions in a sector mass spectrometer or a magnetic sector or electrostatic sector mass spectrometer. So when the ions are formed in the source, okay, they will have some potential energy, okay, and when they are given some acceleration voltage, which is in the range of 4 to 10 kV, okay, that means ions gain that much of translation energy. Okay, they gain acceleration voltage, which is given by 1 by 2 mv square, and the potential energy is given by Zv. M is mass of the ion, V is the velocity, Z is the charge, and capital V stands for acceleration voltage. So in the they enter into the magnetic field and subjected to magnetic field. So in the magnetic field, they are subjected to two kinds of forces. One is centripetal force and centrifugal force. That is, one is towards the magnetic field and one is away from the magnetic field. So that is given by the simple equation mv square by r is equal to bzv. R is radius of curvature and b is the magnetic field. So when you combine both these equations, you arrive at the basic mass spectrometry equation, that is m by z is equal to p square r square by 2v. Okay, basically in sector mass spectrometers, either the magnetic field or the acceleration voltage are scanned such that ion after ion, they pass through the analyzer and reach the detector. So this is a schematic diagram of double focusing mass spectrometer. As I told you, single focusing mass spectrometers have a lot of limitations, particularly with respect to resolution. To overcome this problem, you know, like an electrostatic sector is placed either before the magnetic sector or the after the magnetic sector. So they are called, you know, like conventional geometry and, you know, like reverse geometries. And this electrostatic sector acts like an energy filter. That means ions which have the same kinetic energy are allowed to pass through the electrostatic sector. So this imparts high resolution to the mass spectrometer. So I will not go into the details. I think that earlier days we used to discuss a lot about those things like kinetic energy release, etc. But these days, I think. So now that's all about the sector mass spectrometers. Now we come to quadrupole mass spectrometry or quadrupole mass spectrometer. In quadrupole mass spectrometers, the ions are analyzed by means of a quadrupole field, which is produced by means of four hyperbolic rods, which are placed in a square, okay, in the corners of a square, and they have opposite, the adjacent rods have opposite polarities, and a combination of RF and DC voltage is used to mass separate the ions. So at a ratio, particular ratio of RF and DC voltage, only the ions of a particular M by Z value will have stable oscillations, okay. They go through this collector slit and reach the detector, and other ions, they strike the walls of the rods. So that is how, after the ions are produced in the source, they are injected into this quadrupole field, and ions, they pass through this with the variation of RF and DC voltage. In fact, the ratio is monitored. And these quadrupole mass spectrometers are very simple to operate and easy to maintain, you know, and fast scanning. So is easy as compared to sector mass spectrometers, because, you know, like in sector mass spectrometers, the high voltages are very high, okay, 4 to 10 kV, whereas quadrupole mass spectrometers do not require that much of acceleration voltage, okay. And they can be easily hyphenated with GC or LC-MS as compared to sector mass spectrometers. So other component is, very briefly, the electron multiplier. It's also called secondary electron multiplier. See, the secondary electron multiplier consists of a series of dynodes which are placed at increasing potentials. Okay, when the ion comes and strikes the first dynode, okay, it loses its charge. Okay, then electrons are produced, and these electrons are attracted to the next dynode, and the amplification takes place. That means more number of electrons are produced. As this process continues, a cascade of electrons are produced. Okay, the typical amplification of current gain of an electron multiplier is about 1 billion. So basically, the ions are converted to ion current. Okay. And this is processed by the data system, and then you get signals in the mass spectrum. Now I will discuss about mass resolution. As I told you, mass resolution is very important. The high resolution mass spectrometry is very important because you get the elemental composition information from the accurate masses, and which helps in structural sedation. Okay. What is mass resolution? It's the ability of a mass spectrometer to distinguish two adjacent ions of masses, say M1 and M2. Okay, it's the same mass, but in the decimals, and which differ very slightly in M by Z ratio, say in the decimals. I mean, like third decimal, fourth decimals. That's millimass units, and you know, like ppm. This is given by the equation R is equal to the resolution is equal to M by delta M. Delta M is the difference between the accurate masses of two adjacent ions. Okay? And the value of resolution can be expressed in terms of either full width at off maximum or the 10% value. Okay. Generally, this full width at off maximum is used in time of flight mass spectrometers, wherein you monitor only single peak, the peak 100, and the peak width is peak width can be taken at 5% height or 50% height, depending on sometimes the company. Okay. And for example, 500 divided by 0.1, if the width is 0.1, the resolution required is 5000, or the resolution attained is 5000. And this also can be expressed in terms of a 10% valid definition. This is if two equal height peaks are considered to be resolved, when the valley between the two ions is 10% of the height of these two peaks. And the importance of high resolution can be illustrated with a couple of examples. For example, these are the two adjacent ions, 100.000 and 100.005. If they are sub-valley, the resolution required is 20,000. Okay? See, under low resolution conditions, you would observe only one peak at M by 28, okay, which may correspond to either nitrogen or carbon monoxide or ethylene. Whereas under high resolution, say around 4000, you can clearly see three peaks corresponding to the accurate masses of carbon monoxide, ethylene, and nitrogen. So that is how high resolution helps in the separation of the ions. For example, here the nominal mass is 249. Okay, so this may correspond to a mixture of three different ions or molecular ions or fragment ions. Okay, but they have same nominal mass. So under low resolution conditions, we observe only one peak, whereas under the high resolution conditions, three peaks corresponding to three different. This clearly shows that, you know, like each elemental composition or each molecular formula has a unique accurate mass. So based on this principle, the elemental composition of the accurate masses are produced. I mean, you can either calculate or, you know, like data system can do the job. I think it's clear. So nominal mass is calculated using C, carbon is equal to 12, H is equal to 1, nitrogen is equal to 14, S is equal to 32. Whereas exact masses or accurate masses are calculated using C is equal to 12 only, H is equal to 1.0078, nitrogen 14.0031. So they are well documented in textbooks. Okay, supposing these two have the accurate masses, you know, which differ in ppm level, and the resolution required to separate these two ions is almost 97,273. So that's all about high resolution. So basically, each molecular formula has a unique accurate mass. So based on that, so high resolution mass spectrometry works, and you get elemental compositions for accurate masses. So now I just move on to another technique called chemical ionization. As I told you, it's a software ionization technique. In chemical ionization, sample molecules are ionized by ion molecule reactions between reagent ions and sample molecules. Okay, and this process occurs at a high pressure, relatively high pressure, say 1 bar, and excess of reagent gas is taken as compared to the amount of ion. So almost 1000 is 1. Okay, and these reagent ions, what are these reagent ions? These reagent ions are produced from reagent gases. In chemical ionization mass spectrometry, commonly used reagent gases are methane, isobutane, and ammonia. And as far as the instrumentation is concerned, you know, like ion source assembly is similar to electron ionization chamber with little modifications. See, like the source slit, a fine source slit is used as compared to the EA source, and it is made, the chamber is made gas tight by closing all the apertures. Okay, and In chemical ionization, you require higher ionization energies, more than 70 electron volts, because the excess of reagent gas is used so that, you know, like the ions cannot penetrate. And efficient pumping system is also used to remove CI reagent gases. So in chemical ionization mass spectrometry, so basically three steps are involved in the CI process. The ionization occurs through variety of ion molecule reactions. The most prominent one is acid-base proton transfer reaction. For example, if you take methane as the reagent gas, okay, the first step, it gets ionized by means of electrons to produce methane molecular ions. It undergoes a series of ion molecule reactions with other methane molecules to produce Ci plasma, that is chemical ionization plasma, which contains the reagent ions, mainly CH5 plus, C2HY plus, etc. This CH5 plus acts like a Bronsted acid. That means it can transfer a proton to a sample molecule which has more proton affinity than methane. Okay, so these are the ionization, you know, various processes by which the sample molecules are ionized in chemical ionization mass spectrometry. First one is proton transfer. That is CH5 plus transfers a proton to the sample molecules to produce M plus H. It should be called protonated molecule. Okay, it should not be called molecular ion. Okay, it should be called protonated molecule. As I told you, in chemical ionization mass spectrometry, various types of ion molecules reactions occur. The prominent one is a proton transfer. The CH5 plus, which acts like a Bronsted acid, transfers a proton to molecule to form M plus H. So please note that it should be called protonated molecule. It should not be called molecular ion, pseudo molecular ion. These are all obsolete terms. Okay, and it should be called only protonated molecule. And adduct formation also takes place to form M plus CH5 plus, that is 17 addition, and also 29 addition, like C2H5 plus addition. And under certain conditions, hydride ion abstraction also can take place to form M minus H ions. So what are the other reagent gases which are commonly used in chemical ionization is isobutane CI and ammonia CI. Isobutane CI mainly produce C4H9 plus as the reagent ion. It can either transfer a proton to the sample molecule to form M plus H, and it can also form adduct ions, M plus 57, which is highly characteristic for isobutane CI. And ammonia, it forms, it can, NH4 plus is the reagent ion, and it can transfer the proton to sample molecules to form protonated molecule or adduct ion. So depending on the proton affinity of the analyte molecules, okay? And as compared to methane CI, isobutane CI provides low fragmentation, and you get M plus C4H9 plus M plus 57 ions. So basically the CI spectra are very simple. You don't find much fragmentation because it's a soft ionization technique. And ionization takes place by ion molecule reactions instead of electron bombardment. However, some fragmentation takes place, and the extent of fragmentation is controlled by choice of reagent gas, in turn the proton affinity of the sample molecules. And the amount of energy transferred during the protonation reaction is a function of exothermicity, that is minus the delta H of the reaction. And this is the acid-base reaction. And energy transferred is equal to the difference in the proton affinity of the reagent gas and the sample molecules. And the chemical ionization process is more efficient when the proton affinity of the sample molecules is higher than the proton affinity of the reagent gas. Then only you see the transfer of proton. And the heat liberated during protonation reaction is called the proton affinity. For example, methane CI transfers more energy than isobutane CI, because of their proton affinity. So I will just come to that with one example. I'll just show you some EI and CI spectra. This is the EI spectrum of cyclohexanone. As you can see, lot of fragmentation. And whereas the CI spectrum of cyclohexanone is very simple, it shows only M plus 1 ion, that is 99, and M plus 29, that is C2H5 plus adduct. So even simple molecules like this, you know, like pyrrolidine carboxylic acid, which has a molecular weight of 115, do not show molecular ion under electron ionization conditions. You see, 115 is totally absent. Whereas under chemical ionization, it gives an intense protonated molecule at M by Z 116. So chemical ionization is also used for confirming the molecular weight of the sample, which do not give molecular ion under EA conditions, or insignificant abundance molecular ion under EA conditions. So it is also used as a confirmation technique. So this is one example, you know, like where the analyte is common, and different reagent gases are used to record the mass spectrum of this sample. The analyte is lavandule acetate, whose proton affinity is 8.7 electron volts. It can be in electron volts, it can be in kilocalories per mole, it can be kilojoules per mole. Okay, so all are available in the textbooks. The methane CI mass spectrum of this sample doesn't show M plus H, okay, because the difference in the proton affinity is 8.7 minus 5.7 eV is almost 3 electron volts. So 3 electron volts, you know, 1 electron volts is equal to 23 kilocalories per mole. So it's quite a lot of excess energy. So even if the protonated molecule is formed, you know, like it undergoes extensive fragmentation, leaving no information on the molecular weight of the sample. Whereas if you take isobutane CI, the proton affinity is only 0.2 electron volts. So therefore, the isobutane CI shows an intense M plus H and only one fragment ion, similar to methane CI, which is formed by CO cleavage, which is shown here. And the ammonia CI shows two ions. One is M plus H and another one is M plus NH4. Sorry, this mass is incorrect. So additional confirmation. So why? Because the ammonia gas proton affinity is higher than the proton affinity of the analyte molecule. So that is how you can tailor the CI experiments to suit your needs. That's all about chemical ionization mass spectrometry. So now I just move on to negative ions. See, as you might be aware, you know, during ionization process, in addition to positive ions, negative ions are also formed. But these negative ions remain undetected because the focusing potentials, like ion source potentials and focusing potentials, even including detector. So you have to modify the potentials or the polarities to detect the negative ions. These negative ions are formed by electron capture by sample molecules. So there are basically three mechanisms by which the negative ions can be formed in the source. One is the capture of near thermal energy electrons, okay, which have almost zero electron volts. So how these thermal energy electrons are produced in the source? By using moderate gases like methane, nitrogen, etc. Okay, these are all the moderate gases which can be used to produce the thermal electrons. When such thermal electrons are available, depending on the electron affinity of the sample, it can capture the electrons to form negative ions, okay, negative ion radical, which corresponds to molecular ion. And if the electrons are in the range of 0 to 15 electron volts, so they can be captured to produce dissociative electron capture. So as given by this equation, A minus plus B dot, okay. So the dissociation takes place. So I covered resonance electron capture, okay, by capture of zero electron volts, you know, the thermal energy electrons, which can be produced in the source by using moderate gases such as hydrogen, methane, isobutane, ammonia, nitrogen, etc. By capture of zero electron volts, the molecules can form, you know, negative ions. This is called resonance electron capture. The second one is dissociative electron capture, that is the capture of electrons which have the energies in the range 0 to 15 electron volts, A minus plus B dot, A minus, I think minus is not visible. And the third mechanism is ion pair formation. This happens by capture of electrons which have more than 10 electron volts to form A minus plus B plus, etc. This resonance electron capture is very good for high electron affinity compounds, like compounds containing nitro group, halo group, conjugated pi electron system. So it should be positive. The electron affinity should be positive, more than zero. Then only the molecules can form electron, say like negative ions. Generally, you know, like 2.5 electrons is sufficient actually. So negative ions are also generated by ion molecule reactions with reagent ions, right? And this is basically acid-base reactions. When the strength of B minus ion, when is B minus ion is a stronger base than the sample molecule, it can abstract a proton from the sample molecule to form a minus H minus, okay? So these are the reagent ions which can be easily produced under negative ion chemical ionization conditions like NH2 minus, OH minus, O minus dot, methoxy, okay? Methoxy anion, F minus, F2 minus, and Cl minus. The Cl minus is omnipresent. If you are using some solvent like dichloromethylene, see like Cl minus will be present. So these are the mechanisms by which, you know, like various negative ions are formed, like O minus dot, OH minus dot, O minus dot, methoxy, okay? And, you know, they can give rise to adduct ion formation, okay? Sometimes, you know, like you get M minus H and also adduct ion formation. For example, Cl minus is very popular. It forms M plus Cl minus with various types of analytes. Okay, this is a resonance electron capture. You get the clear M minus dot at M by Z 252. And this is dissociative electron capture, where in addition to M minus dot, you also get fragmentation. You can note that, you know, like compounds containing nitro group and chlorine, you know, they form negative ions very easily with very high sensitivity. Generally, the sensitivity of negative ion mass spectrometry is much less as compared to positive ions, that you are aware, I think. Okay, this is the Cl minus spectrum, which shows M plus Cl minus of adduct ion of glucose. Okay, that's a nice adduct at M by Z 215. And this Cl minus ion formed by electron ionization of dichloromethylene or a combination of methane dichloromethylene and mixes of Cl2, CF2. So they basically form stable hydrogen bonded complexes with several acids, amides, aromatic amines, and phenols. I have not shown many spectra. I just gave only one example. Other analytes are polychlorinated aliphatic compounds, organophosphorus pesticides, and oligosaccharides. Okay, for pesticides, negative ion chemical ionization is one of the best techniques. Now, that's all about negative ion mass spectrometry or negative ion chemical ionization mass spectrometry. Now I just move on to interpretation of mass spectra. So when you want to interpret a mass spectrum, you should try to get all available information. Okay, maybe a research scholar or a supervisor, okay, should get all the information. Basically, how the sample was synthesized. So if it is a natural product, how it was isolated, what kinds of solvents were used, including, you know, glassware, what type of glassware and which glassware was used. Because often you see artifact peaks in the mass spectrum. These artifact peaks are very difficult to interpret. For example, some samples react with glasses, okay? They form borosilicate complexes. They give rise to very intense and very clean mass spectra. In fact, that itself, you know, like a good topic actually, isotope artifact peaks. Okay, so you should be careful and get all the information before interpreting a mass spectrum. And you look at the general appearance of the mass spectrum. If you see intense peaks of low M by Z values, okay, that in the low mass region, if you see intense peaks, it indicates could be aliphatic compounds. If you rarely see intense peaks, if there are no intense peaks and just only one or two, it indicates aromatic compound. So basically, aliphatic compounds gives a series of peaks corresponding to CnH2n plus 1 series, like 29, okay, 43, 57, 71, very intense peaks with a characteristic pattern. Okay, so you can easily identify. And everybody's concern is to, you know, like identify the molecular ion peak, whether your compound is formed or not. And mass of molecular ion is nothing but sum of atomic masses of most abundant isotopic species. What do you mean by most abundant isotopic species? See, like between carbon 12 and carbon 13, carbon 12 is most abundant. Chlorine 35 and chlorine 37, it is. Chlorine 35 is most abundant. Many people, you know, like because of their you know, unfamiliarity, they take 37 also for calculation. Even the bromine 81 they take. Some people take 35.5. So you should take only nominal mass. Then only you get the correct molecular weight. And in the mass spectra, you get isotopic peaks, which appear as satellite peaks. In the mass spectra, I'll be showing, I think, a couple of spectra just to show you what are these isotopic peaks for the benefit of the youngsters. And from the percentage of isotopic peaks, it is possible to establish elemental composition. And to identify a peak as molecular ion, there are certain guidelines, but they are not must, you know, like. So it should be maximum M by Z value in the spectrum, okay? So the last peak in the spectrum should correspond to the molecular ion, and it should be odd electron ion, okay? And the high M by Z primary fragment ions, that is region below the molecular ion, it should show the peaks which correspond to logical losses, like loss of methyl, loss of ethyl, loss of H2O or NH3 or ROH, etc. But it should not correspond to some odd masses. If you see some odd peaks, say loss of 14, loss of 20, 21, etc. So that means your identification of the molecular ion is incorrect. Okay. And another one is the another important guideline is the molecular ion should contain all the elements present in the fragment ions. Supposing you see chlorine pattern in the fragment ions, okay, one of the fragment ions. And if it is absent in the molecular ion region, so that means you have not identified your molecular ion correctly. Okay. So that is, these are some of the guidelines. Okay. These are the mass spectra of some simple organic molecules like benzoic acid, salicylaldehyde, and benzodiazole. The molecular ion is 122. And adjacent to that, there is a satellite peak at M by Z 123. This is called isotopic peak. And without the presence of isotopic peaks, there is no meaning for the mass spectra. They deserve only junk marks, okay? And the tallest peak in the spectrum is called base peak, all of you are aware. And the spectrum should show only one base peak, okay? And if too many peaks are touching the top, so again, it can, you know, it deserves only junk marks. And all these three compounds, they have the same molecular weight, but the different fragmentation pattern. Okay, so that means an EA spectrum is unique to each molecule. Okay, so each person has unique characters. So each molecule has a unique EA spectrum. So based on this fact, databases are built, like NIST, Wiley databases, which contain, you know, like millions of mass spectra, known mass spectra. And after recording the mass spectra, one can do library search if you have a data system, if you have ordered for a data system. Then library search gives some matching spectra with some matching factor. If the matching factor is more than 90, then you can confirm the structure of your sample. Okay, that's all about the EI mass spectra and the isotopic peaks. Okay, so isotopic peaks, the satellite peaks should be present adjacent to even the fragment ions. Okay, like for example, MYZ-105 is, and you have a MYZ-106, which corresponds to, which is an isotopic peak. And the most stable ion, okay, base peak corresponds to the most stable structure that can be formed from the sample molecule. Need not be molecular ion. So now I'm going to talk about the importance of natural abundances of the isotopes and how you derive the elemental composition from the percentage of the isotopic peaks. The isotopic peaks in the mass spectra arise due to natural abundance of various elements. And from the percentage of isotopic peaks, you can determine molecular formula or elemental composition. Okay, and these are the elements which we come across very often in organic and biological mass spectrometry. Hydrogen, for all practical purposes, it is taken as a single isotope only, because the abundance is much less. Okay, and carbon has C13 abundance is 1.1%. Nitrogen 15 is 0.366, and oxygen O18 is 0.2, and this is monoisotopic, fluorine and phosphorus, similar to hydrogen. And sulfur, S34, it has 4.22 abundance. It's very prominent. The presence of sulfur in a compound can be guessed easily from the abundance of M plus 2 peak. Okay, and S33 is also okay. It's 0.76%. And chlorine, of course, these are very popular. Cl37 is 24%, and bromine 81 and bromine 79. They have equal abundance. And iodine is monoisotopic. So all these elements can be categorized into three groups. As explained, it is like A, it's a monoisotopic, A plus 1, A plus 2. For example, chlorine and bromine, they comes under A plus 2 groups. Okay. So C13, N15 and S33, they contribute to the intensity of M plus 1 ion. Okay. Whereas O18, S34, chlorine 35, bromine 81, they contribute their abundance to the intensity of M plus 2 peak. I hope it is clear. So for example, if you take methane, okay, the molecular weight is 16. Okay. The intensity of M plus 1 peak, that is 17, MYZ17, has the intensity of 1.1%, because it has only one carbon. If you go to ethane, it has 2.2%, propane 3.3%. So if you know the number of carbons, you are able to predict, okay, the intensity of the M plus 1 peak. Okay. Similarly, you can predict the intensity of M plus 2 peak with the addition of the abundance, isotopic abundance of other atoms like oxygen, sulfur, etc., or chlorine. Okay, and vice versa, from the intensity, you can calculate the molecular formula. Is it true or not? So, from the intensities of M plus 1 peak and M plus 2 peak, you can calculate the molecular formula. So, let us see how we can do it. See, for there are some simple formula. Compounds containing carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, the PM plus 1 is given by intensity of M plus 1 divided by intensity of M multiplied by 100. It is simple. The percentage of M plus 1 you get is equal to number of carbons multiplied by 1.1. Okay, because it contains one carbon, right? And PM plus 2, then you substitute the number of carbons in this formula. See, like this is the equation, whole square divided by 200. I don't know how this has come, but it is, I will not go into the details. And 0.2, that is O18, abundance is 0.2 multiplied by number of oxygens. And compounds containing carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen. So you have to add nitrogen abundance contribution to the m plus 1 intensity, and m plus 2 is similar to that of CHO, because only oxygen is present. And for compounds containing carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, and oxygen, so you have to add the contribution of sulfur, that is 0.366 number of sulfurs, that is S33. Okay, S33 has an abundance of 0.366, and whereas S34 has 4.22. Okay, so that is how using these equations you can calculate the molecular formula. So I have just given one worked out formula. So the spectrum shows the molecular at molecular ion at m by z 164. Okay, the intensity of 165, m by z 165 is 11%, and the intensity of 166 is 1%. Okay, since there are no nitrogens, you know very well, because from the spectrum, the number of carbons is given by 11 divided by 1.1. So you get number of carbons is equal to 10. So then you substitute this in this equation, okay, and PM plus 2, you get this is 0.6 plus 0.2y number of oxygens is equal to 1, because the intensity of m plus 2 is equal to 1. Then you get 0.4, okay, then you get the number of oxygens is equal to 2. Once you know the number of oxygens and the number of carbons, you can calculate number of hydrogens. So that is how we know, like C10, H12 and O2. Okay, that's the molecular formula arrived at. Okay, I hope it is clear. So you can do more if anybody is interested. You can do exercise at home and get familiarized with these simple calculations. In the interpretation, this ring plus double bonds is also very important. Okay, this R plus dB value, which you get automatically under high resolution conditions. Okay, it's a measure of the degree of unsaturation in a molecule. Okay, you can tell, you can identify whether it is, you know, like one single bond or two single bonds or triple bond, etc. And from the R plus dB value, you can also find out whether it is an odd electron ion or even electron species. Okay, R plus dB value will be an integer number for odd electron ions, and for even electron ions, it is odd multiple of 0.5. Okay, there is a simple formula Cx, Hy, Nz, On. Okay, then I have given R plus dB for some known compounds. Okay, this is C8H8O, C6H7N. Okay, you can easily calculate. X is the number of carbons. Okay, Z is number of hydrogens, right? And of course, oxygen is not given because its valency is 2. Plus 1, you get 5. This is, okay. So this indicates that they're all, integer values, no? Like it indicates they're all molecular ion, odd electron ions. So that is how you can find out whether the molecular formula corresponds to an odd electron ion or even electron ion. Okay. So generally in chemical annihilation, this M plus H ion, that's an even electron species. They are highly stable. Okay. Whereas cation radicals are unstable. Therefore, they undergo more fragmentation as compared to even electron species. They are closed shell species. I hope it is clear. The interpretation continues. You can check the correctness of M plus dot on the base of primary fragment ions, which I already discussed. The primary fragment ion should not correspond to, you know, like loss of 5 to 14, 21 to 25, 37, 38. I have seen many people writing loss of 14, which they say CH2 loss, which is incorrect. It's energetically not feasible. Okay. So presence of, you know, like a loss of 14 indicates that there is some impurity, high molecular weight impurity in your sample. Okay. I'm just particularly telling about the loss of 14, which is not an energetically feasible process. And many compounds do not give molecular ion under electron impact conditions. then you can resort to low energy EI, or that means, you know, like you can reduce the ionization energy from 70 electron volts to 40 and sometimes 20 electron volts. And if you see very low abundance molecular ion, then you can use chemical ionization for conformation of the molecular ion. So we have already discussed base peak. Base peak is nothing but ion with greatest abundance. It need not be M plus dot. Generally, it corresponds to the most stable structure that can be formed from the sample molecule. For example, in case of benzoic acid, it is benzoyl cation, because the positive charge in the benzoyl cation is stabilized by means of resonance. So that's the reason M by Z195 is very stable. And as I told you, mass spectrum is like a fingerprint of molecular structure. So each molecule has a unique structure, except isomers. For example, you cannot differentiate between 1-hexene and 2-hexene, because they undergo isomerization under electron ionization conditions. So except isomers. And computer databases can be used to identify unknown compounds. I have already discussed that. And apply nitrogen rule. So compounds with odd number of nitrogens, the molecular ion appears at odd mass, and compounds with even or zero number of nitrogens, the molecular ion appears at even mass. Like for examples are given here, methane 16, ammonia 17, because it has odd number of nitrogens. Okay, this has odd number of nitrogens, it's 129. And from the isotopic pattern, you can determine the elemental composition that I have already demonstrated. And if the molecular ion is of low abundance, then composition of the next abundant fragment ion is taken. And then you add the masses of the neutral that is lost during the fragmentation. For example, if a compound, alcohol, loses H2O, okay, then you take a fragment ion and derive the elemental composition and add 18, so that you arrive at the elemental composition. So that is how elemental composition is derived. Okay, and so then, you know, like odd and even electron ions, odd electron ions are formed by removal of an electron in electron ionization mass spectrometry. This is denoted by using a plus dot, which is placed on top of the molecular formula or the structure. And generally, odd electron ions, they undergo isomerization to stable ions, which are dystolic ions, where the ion charge and radical are separated. Okay, and this is how the fragmentation takes place. When odd electron ion undergoes fragmentation, it can give rise to another odd electron radical and even electron species. This is very normal. And odd electron ion giving rise to another odd electron ion is highly characteristic of rearrangement reactions. And even electron species, generally it gives rise to even electron species, which is energetically a facile process. Whereas the even electron species giving rise to an odd electron ion is high energy reaction. Generally, you don't see such fragmentations in the organic mass spectrometry or whatever it is. Even if you see, you know, the ion corresponding to that odd electron ion is much less of abundance. Okay, so these are again some more general guidelines. So basically, three types of information is obtained from the mass spectra. But one is molecular mass, elemental composition, and the compound specific fragment ions. So not all compounds can be identified on the basis of information from a mass spectrum. Sometimes it is highly complementary to NMR and IR. And determination of molecular mass can be done, you know, using low resolution or high resolution. And low resolution mass spectrometry provides nominal mass. Okay. And elemental composition can be derived from isotopic pattern. Okay. And in case of high resolution mass spectrometry, you determine the exact mass, that is the accurate mass up to 4 decimal, from which, you know, you can derive the elemental composition using the database. And an acceptable value of the measured mass should be within 5 ppm of the accurate mass. Then only most of the journals accept for publication. Okay. And molecular formula from accurate masses, how it is done, you know, it is fortunately the atomic masses of isotopes are non-integers. Okay. Which are, as I told you, like 14.00 in case of nitrogen, and 15.005, etc. For, you know, these are all non-integer masses. This feature imparts a unique value to the molecular mass of each compound or each formula. A nominal mass mass may have several combinations of elements positions. For example, if you take 70 nominal mass, so these are all the possible elemental formation, elemental compositions or molecular formula, but each molecular formula has accurate mass. So because of this, you know, like you can find out the elemental composition. So each has a unique exact mass value. Okay, so that's the reason from the accurate mass you can derive the elemental composition using a computer, or it can be done manually also. Okay, the presence of chlorine, bromine, sulfur, silicon can be easily detectable from the intensity of M+2 peak. Okay, and M+2 intensity, if it is less than 3% of the molecular ion, you can rule out the presence of chlorine, bromine, sulfur, silicon, because sulfur 34, everything is more than 3%. And if any number of A+2 elements, then you get N+1 peaks of the isotopic peaks, which are separated by two mass units. Okay, and these intensities of these isotopic peaks can be easily calculated using binomial formula, which is given by A+B^n. A is equal to 3, B is equal to 1 for chlorine. Okay, and for bromine is equal to, A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 1. If there are 3 chlorine atoms, then you get 4 peaks in the molecular ion region. Molecular ion M+2, M+4, M+6. Okay, and the intensities of these peaks can be derived using this simple binomial formula. I think they're, most of you are aware. So these are the halogen exceptions, and depending on the number of chlorines, chlorine, bromines, etc. are present, these are the abundances of isotope peaks in the molecular ion region. So these are some real examples. Okay, like M/190 is the molecular ion, 192 is the M+2, and 194 is M+4. Okay, and you can manually also, you can easily arrive at the percentage of these peaks. Okay, I think it used to be given below, but doesn't matter, I think. So when it comes to interpretation, I mean, the intensity of M+ dot, that's a molecular ion, decreases with the chain length and chain branching, that you know very well. And the long chain aliphatic compounds show characteristic hydrocarbon pattern corresponding to CnH2n+1 ion series. Okay, the low mass ion series, which I already told you, are, you know, like M by 29, 43, 57, 71. This indicates alkanes and aliphatic ketones. Alkenes and cycloalkanes produce a series of ions at M by 27, 41, 55, 69. And if you see the ions, even mass ions in the low mass region, that indicates presence of sulfur, or, you know, like sometimes the rearrangement reactions. So long chain alcohols and ethers, they show characteristic ions at M by Z 31. This is nothing but CH2 double bond OH and one.
Dr. Srinivas, can I make a comment here? Because the previous slide, just to reiterate what you said, the previous slide. Yeah, you did mention that there is no loss of 14 in mass spectrometry, and that could be coming from impurities. But if we take this alkenes, etc., if you see 27, 41, 55, 69, they appear as if there is a 14 loss, and that is a good indication of it is a long chain hydrocarbon.
Long chain hydrocarbon, yeah. They correspond to, you know, like, for example, 71, 57 difference is 14. But 57 is not formed from 71.
I perfectly agree. It appears.
Yeah.
Appearance is a good indication that it's a long chain hydrocarbon.
Long chain hydrocarbon. Yes.
Because they cleave at different carbons. That whatever, correct. Different carbon atoms.
Yeah.
One after another. That is the reason. That's Thank true. You. Yeah. Just to reiterate what you said.
Yeah, that's true. And long chain alcohols and ethers, they show these ions M by Z 31, like corresponding to CH2 double bond OH, 45 addition of one more alkyl group, etc. Okay, these are all the characteristic ions. And compounds containing phenyl group, they show a series of characteristic ions, particularly starting from phenyl cation 63, 51, MBZ 39. And if you observe a peak at MBZ 91, it indicates the presence of benzyl group. Okay, then this is very important. If you observe odd electron ions in the spectrum corresponding to, say, MBZ 60, 74, 92, that indicates that there is some rearrangement, specific rearrangement, which may correspond to, you know, like megaloperty rearrangement, etc. Okay, this basically you get a clue to the presence of certain functional groups from the ions in the low mass region as well as high mass region. Particularly the intense ions in the high mass region, they throw some light on the structure of the sample. And now, some more information. So when a molecule undergoes ionization, either a sigma electron can be removed, or a pi electron can be removed, or an electron can be removed. Okay, the order of preference for the removal of electron is first comes the non-bonding electron, because it requires less energy, followed by conjugated pi electron, and s electron. S electron removal requires a lot of energy. So basically, the fragmentation involves either the direct bond cleavages, okay, or some rearrangement reactions, mostly direct bond cleavages. These direct bond cleavages occur via competitive pathways. So what do you mean by competitive pathways? If there are two pathways, see, one requires more energy, one requires less energy. So the fragmentation follows the pathway which requires less energy, okay? And these energies can be calculated from heat of formation values and, you know, like theoretical calculations, which is not required now. And when a fragmentation takes place, the retention of charge, okay? So one species will retain the charge and another species goes with the radical. The retention of charge is governed by Stevenson rule, which says that the ion with less ionization energy goes with the charge, positive charge, and the radical, the species which has more ionization energy carries the radical, okay? So if you take a hypothetical molecule like ABCD, one would observe, you know, a lot of fragmentation corresponding to simple cleavages. And this is a type of cleavage which corresponds to rearrangement reactions. And if the sample contains branching, that's a place where the fragmentation can take place easily, because it's a facile cleavage which leads to the formation of a stable ion. Okay, the positive charge on the carbon is stabilized by means of hyperconjugation. So that's the reason the tertiary butyl cation is more intense. So as far as the stability is concerned, tertiary comes first, then the secondary, followed by the primary. Okay, and if a compound contains groups like this, methyl, ethyl, hydrogen, and propyl, the loss of the largest alkyl group leads to the more abundant ion. Okay, this is a thumb rule. Okay, why the molecular ion undergoes fragmentation? The fragmentation is basically initiated by electron in the hetero atom. Okay, for example, ethers, alcohols, ketones, esters, amines, and alkanes. So what is the driving force? The driving force is the radical character of this cation radical, which is formed under electron ionization conditions. And there is a tendency for electron pairing. Okay, one electron from this bond comes here, okay, with the loss of R1 dot. Okay, and this kind of cleavage is called homolytic cleavage. Okay, and this is also alpha cleavage, because the alpha bond with respect to the hetero atom is getting cleaved in this fragmentation. And this alpha cleavage is indicated by fish hook arrow. Okay, and the movement of two electrons is indicated by a full arrow. And alpha cleavage with the charge migration can also appear, particularly when the ionization energy of R1 plus is much less than the radical counterpart. Okay, so but mostly it's a charge retention on the hetero atom. So these are all the examples for alpha cleavage fragmentation. So the positive charge is on the oxygen is stabilized by means of resonance, And if you take ketones, as I told you, the loss of largest alkyl group leads to the most stable ion. So compounds containing acetyl groups invariably show an intense ion at MZ43 in the mass spectrum. And when it comes to alcohols, this is the ion at MZ31, this is the ion at MZ30, because the charge on the nitrogen is highly stabilized by this double bond, and whereas oxygen similar, okay? And compounds containing double bonds, they undergo allylic cleavages, okay? This is called homoallylic cleavage, and to produce allyl cations, okay? This is characteristic of compounds containing double bonds. And in case of alkyl aromatics, as I told you, an intense ion at MZ91 appears, okay? This is due to the ring enlargement reaction. The benzyl cation undergoes the more stable propylium cation. I would finally show how, you know, like, you can derive the protonated molecule from the multiply charged ions from ESI, okay? Basically, it is done by the computer. So how it can be done, you know, like, I'll quickly show that. These are the things which have already discussed. I'll just skip this. And now I will go through the fragmentation pattern, the characteristic fragmentation pattern of different types of molecules or different groups of molecules. When it comes to alkane, okay, the abundance of molecular ion is less, it's of less abundance, and the fragmentation pattern contains clusters of peaks, 14 mass units apart, which represent loss of CH2 and CH3, alkyl group, okay? And, you know, the low mass region shows a characteristic pattern like this. And when the branching is present in the molecule, fragmentation occurs at the branching point, leading to the less abundant molecular ion as compared to its isomeric hydrocarbon. So these are the mass spectra of isomeric C16 hydrocarbons. Okay, this is a straight chain hydrocarbon without any branching. It almost shows insignificant, it's very low abundant molecular ion, whereas its isomer, which has branching in the molecule, the molecular ion is totally absent. Okay, so wherever the branching is present, you know that it's a point of facile cleavage, and because it means it requires less energy, and that's a more dominating process. Okay, this is another example. So this, the spectrum clearly shows only tertiary butyl cation. Now I'll quickly discuss about the mass spectra of alkenes. The double bond imparts stability to the molecular ion as compared to alkanes. You can see, you know, like intense molecular ions, and the characteristic peak is the allyl cation, okay, and the charge is stabilized by resonance. So isomerization occurs through migration of double bond. Okay, this is very interesting example. Okay, isomerization occurs through double bond. So this is the EI mass spectrum of beta myosin. I'm sorry for the quality of the spectrum. You can easily explain the peaks at MZ 63, very intense peaks, and 69 and 67 easily. But the peak at MZ 93, which corresponds to loss of propyl radical, okay, it's difficult to explain. It can be explained only through isomerization of the double bond. Okay, this double bond is getting isomerized to form this structure, which can undergo fragmentation to lose propyl radical to give MZ93 ion, very intense 93 ion. So that means the isomerization occurs through the migration of double bonds. So these are the mass spectra of some saturated alicyclic hydrocarbons. Cycloalkane ring has a stable molecular ion, and it shows characteristic peaks at C4H8 corresponding to this one, and C4H8, okay, and the loss of methyl and ethylene. This ethylene, loss of ethylene can be explained with these arrows. And saturated rings lose alpha alkyl chain, and unsaturated rings undergo retro Diels-Alder reaction. This retro Diels-Alder fragmentation may give rise to the fragment ions corresponding to both diene and dienophile, depending on the presence of substituents on the ring, Okay, but I think I'm showing only the diene and dienophile. Okay. And aromatic compounds, they give rise to stable molecular ion because you require more energy to fragment the aromatic molecules. These are the series of ions. Okay, depending on the presence of electron donating substance and electron withdrawing substance. These are the series of ions. Okay, this we have already shown. I think that this kind of ring enlargement reactions can also occur in heteroaromatic compounds. Rearrangement reactions in organic mass spectrometry basically involves hydrogen atom transfers from one group to another group. If you take ester, it loses a molecule of acid, which is similar to loss of H2O from alcohols. And deuterium experiments have confirmed that this hydrogen comes from gamma position, a alpha, beta, gamma position. And when there is no gamma hydrogen in the molecule, so alpha, beta, gamma, there is no hydrogen. So it undergoes a beta hydrogen migration with the loss of ketene in case of this sample. So coming to McLafferty arrangement, I'm sure I think most of you are aware of this. The McLafferty arrangement involves a gamma hydrogen migration to a double bond through a six-membered transition state. Okay, this is a six-membered transition state, which is energetically highly stable. And the McLafferty arrangement requires the presence of multiple bonds like C double bond O, C double bond C, C double bond S, C double bond N, C double bond N, etc. And a gamma hydrogen, okay? And the interatomic distance between the donor and acceptor should be around 1.8 angstroms. And generally, the enol form has been reported to be stable, okay? It retains the enol structure before its fragmentation. These are some of the deuterated experiments with the deuterated compounds, which establishes that the gamma hydrogen exclusively participates in the McLafferty arrangement. For example, this is ethyl butanate, okay? And it's non-deuterated compound. It gives the fragment McLafferty fragment ion at MBZ 88. And when alpha position is deuterated, okay? Alpha D2 is retained in the McLafferty fragment ion. So 88 is shifted to MBZ 90. And when beta position is deuterated, and this is eliminated as olefin, okay? So you get back only MBZ 88. And when gamma position is deuterated, 1D is retained. So MBZ 88 is shifted to MBZ 89. So these are, you know, like this deuterated experiments are very common in organic mass spectrometry to study the mechanism of various fragmentations. So ortho effects is also another important topic, which is very helpful in distinguishing ortho and orthoisomer from meta and para isomers. I'm just giving simple examples, but you know, like this applies to even larger molecules. For example, recently we reported in a pharmaceutical drug, you know, like based on ortho effects, we could distinguish the isomers. And the ortho effects is nothing but the interaction between the ortho groups, okay, in a disubstituted aromatic compound leads to some characteristic fragmentation. For example, this is toluic acid, loses H2O, okay, and this process, the loss of H2O is either insignificant or absent in meta and para isomers. Similarly, this molecule interaction between CONH2 and OH leads to loss of NH3. So basically, this fragmentation involves loss of neutral molecules, which may be either insignificant or totally absent for meta and para isomers. Okay, so this is one example, orthonitrotoluene, okay. This doesn't show molecular ion and it shows MBZ 120 corresponding to loss of OH, which is totally absent in the case of para and meta isomers. Briefly about the peptides, you know, as most of you are aware, the peptide fragmentation is explained by Ropstorff and Pohlmann formula. Peptide has N terminus and C terminus, and because of the fragmentation, it gives rise to some characteristic ions corresponding to ABC and XYZ ions. Okay, particularly this one is very popular, the YN ion, the presence of YN ion corresponding to the peptide cleavage. Okay, it gives the information on the presence of various amino acids present in the peptide. And we have done a lot of work on different types of peptides. Okay, and ammonium ions are also highly characteristic of the presence of the type of amino acid that is present in the sample. That presence of ammonium ion usually suggests the presence of a given amino acid. And of course, generally peptides do not give a molecular ion under like EI or even ESI conditions, also electrospray ionization conditions. You require MSMS, that is tandem mass spectrometry, to fragment the peptide and get the ions, okay? Get the characteristic ions corresponding to various amino acids. I think MSMS probably, I think it should be covered in next lecture. And I'm not going to discuss about LCMS or ESI, but you know, like ESI, as you're aware, it gives multiply charged ions, okay? These multiply charged ions are formed because of the presence of nitrogen-containing compounds, for example, okay? And it gives doubly charged ions and, you know, like multiply charged ions depending on the presence of the number of amino acids. For example, if a peptide whose molecular weight is 50,000, which can generally, using a simple single quad or even triple quad, it's not possible to detect the compounds with the large molecular weight. But whereas with ESI, if ESI is present, even if its capability is only 2000, 3000, you can still detect the molecular weight of samples up to 100,000 or 200,000, even I think 800,000, yeah, okay? This is very simple because 50,000 molecular weight, if it can take 25 charges, the molecular ion or the protonated molecule appears at 2001. So this is a simple equation, and this is how the ubiquitin mass spectrum looks like. These are all the multiply charged ions, but how to get the molecular weight information from these? You can take any two adjacent peaks which are separated by one charge actually. So, and there's use a simple equation, that is charge state of, you have to find out the charge of, say we are taking these two peaks, M2, M1. First, you have to find out the charge on the M2 and multiply with the mass of this. Then you get the molecular weight. So it is done here. M1 is 1224, okay? And M2 is 1428 minus 1224. Then you get the protein mass by this simply, okay, that is done in the next page, I think. Yeah. Okay. The charge on the M2 is given by 1224, that is M1 minus 1. And M2 minus M1, then you get the number of charges on M2. Then you can calculate the protein mass by multiplying with the M2. You get the molecular weight, 8,568.7. So there are softwares, that's deconvolution softwares, which gives automatically the deconvoluted spectrum. Okay. But one should know how this is done actually. So thank you very much for your attention. Yeah.